In this video, we'll study about the histology of the veins. The basic structure of the veins is similar to that of the artery. It has tunica intima, which includes the vascular endothelium and the subendothelial connective tissue. Then you have the tunica media and the tunica adventitia or the externa. In large vein, all these three layers are well defined. Let's see how the structure of the vein differs from that of the artery. The wall of a vein is thinner than that of an artery, which has a same sized lumen. The tunica media contains much larger quantity of collagen than in the artery. The amount of elastic tissue or of the muscle in the tunica media is much less. Because of the differences mentioned above, the wall of the vein is easily compressed. After death, the veins are usually collapsed. In contrast, the arteries retain their patency. In arteries, the tunica media is usually thicker than the adventitia. In contrast, the adventitia of the vein is thicker than the media, especially in the large vein. In some large vein, for example the inferior vena cava, the adventitia contain a considerable amount of elastic and muscle fiber that run predominantly longitudinal direction. These fibers facilitate elongation and shortening of the vena cava with respiration. This is also facilitated by the fact that the collagen fibers in the adventitia form a meshwork that spiral around the vessel. A clear distinction between the tunica intima, tunica media and the tunica adventitia cannot be made out in small vein, as all these layers contain predominantly of fibrous tissue. The muscle fibers are completely absent in the venous spaces of the erectile tissue, in the veins of the cancellous bone, the dural venous sinuses, retinal veins and placental veins. So this is a histological picture of the large vein. So this is the tunica intima, which consists of endothelium, subendothelial connective tissue, and this is the tunica media, which is made up of collagen fibers. And here this is the larger layer, which is the tunica adventitia. In the tunica adventitia of the large vein, you can see the longitudinally running smooth muscle fibers, you can see here. So these are the sections of the longitudinally oriented smooth muscle fibers. This is another histological picture. So here you can see this is the tunica intima, which consists of the endothelium, subendothelial connective tissue, and this is the tunica media, which forms one third of the vessel wall, and this is the tunica adventitia, which forms a two third of the vessel wall. And here you can see the longitudinally oriented smooth muscle fibers, the cut sections of the longitudinally oriented smooth muscle fibers. Next we'll see about the valves of the veins. So these are the valves of the veins. Most veins contain valve that allow the flow of blood towards the heart. So it will allow the blood towards the heart, but prevents the flow in an opposite direction, that is regurgitation. So typically each valve is made up of two semilunar cusps. So this is one semilunar cusp and this is the other one semilunar cusp. Each cusp is a fold of endothelium within which there is some connective tissue that is rich in elastic fibers. The valves are absent in very small veins and in the veins within the cranial cavity or within the vertebral canal, and in some in the vena cavae and in some other veins. The flow of the blood through the veins is assisted by the contraction of the muscles in their walls, and it is also assisted by the contraction of the surrounding muscle, especially when the surrounding muscles are enclosed in deep fascia. Next, we'll see the clinical correlation. So, varicose veins. Varicose veins are permanently dilated and tortuous superficial veins of the lower extremities, especially the long saphenous vein and its tributaries. About 10-12% of the general population develops varicose veins of the lower leg, with a peak incidence in the 4th and the 5th decade of the life. Adult females are affected more commonly than the male, especially during pregnancy, and this is attributed to the venous stasis in the lower legs because of the compression on the iliac veins by the pregnant uterus. Next, we'll see about the venules. The smallest vein into which the capillaries drain are called venules. They are 20 to 30 micrometer in diameter. Their wall consists of endothelium, basal lamina, and a thin adventitia consisting of longitudinally running collagen fibers. Flattened or branching cells, which are called as pericytes, may be present outside the basal lamina of small venules, which are called as the postcapillary venules, while some muscle fibers may be present in the larger vessel, the muscular venules. Functionally, the venules have to be distinguished from the true veins. The walls of the venules, especially those of the postcapillary venules, have considerable permeability, and exchanges between the blood and the surrounding tissue can take place through them. In particular, venules are the sites at which the lymphocytes and other cells may pass out or into the bloodstream. Next, we'll see the blood vessels, lymphatics, and the nerves supplying the blood vessels. The walls of the small blood vessels receive adequate nutrition by diffusion from the blood in their lumina. However, the walls of the large and the medium-sized vessels are supplied by small arteries. So, these are called as vasa vasorum. Vasa vasorum. So literally it means the blood vessel supplying the blood vessel. The singular of vasa vasorum is vas, vasis. So these vessels supply the adventitia and the tunica media. So, the tunica media and the tunica adventitia are supplied by the vasa vasorum. These layers of the vessel also contain many lymphatic vessels. The blood vessels have a fairly rich supply by the autonomic nerves, mainly the sympathetic. The nerves are unmyelinated. Most of the nerves are vasomotor and supply the smooth muscle. Their stimulation causes vasoconstriction in some arteries and vasodilatation in others. Some myelinated sensory nerves are also present in the adventitia.